Hello, everybody. My name is Brady, and I'm a 19th century American historian, and we are back with more Hamilton. We're going to be doing Stay Alive, the first version of the song, not the, I just realized I've never said this word out loud before, the reprise or reprise. There's another version of this song that occurs later on in the play. We're doing the first one. This should be an interesting one. We're kind of in the thick of the war. I skipped over a few things because I'm focusing on the military and political stuff first, and I'll be going back to some of the later song, some of the other songs later on. Yeah, this one should be a lot of fun. I really enjoy this song and the way that it tells stories. I guess the storytelling game on this song is like A+. While it, I know it's, I don't think it's anybody's favorite song in Hamilton. Should be fun though. Let's get it started. Sazoon. Always doing great work.
I have taken over writing all his correspondence. Congress writes, George, attack the British forces. I shoot back, we have resorted to eating our horses.
All the little things are so funny, like the little notes that the animator puts in there. This is during a point where Hamilton is aide-de-camp to Washington. He is quickly the most trusted aide that Washington has, and like I've said in previous videos, Hamilton has way more freedom than a lot of other secretaries would have. He's able to make a lot of decisions on his own without directly consulting Washington. He's just proven himself to be that efficient. So he's in a pretty good position as far as power goes, but however, the overall power of the military is not very good because Congress is not providing the money that they need at this point. A lot of the members are worrying about their own states. They don't have time to be sending money to this army that may or may not actually win. I think a lot of them are taking the army for granted. I think that's one of the biggest problems. They think, like, oh, they can handle it with what they have, but they really have no idea how bad the situation is.
Merchants deny us equipment.
Oh, let me go back.
We have resorted to eating our horses. Local merchants deny us equipment, assistance. They only take British money, so sing a song of sixpence.
That is a very important detail here, because the local merchants don't want to take the colonial money because it's not going to be worth anything if they lose. Unless they come to like a weird agreement with the British where if the British win, they will honor the colonial money. But that's very unlikely that would end up happening. So these merchants are kind of just trying to bet on the winners. And let's be real, the winners seem like it's going to be the British.
Cavalry's not coming, but Sir Alex, listen, there's only one way for us to win this. Provoke outrage. Outright. That's right. Don't engage. Strike by night. Remain relentless till their troops take flight. Make it impossible to justify the cost of the fight.
That is a very concise explanation of how not just this military conflict goes, but a lot of conflicts with large, powerful nations and smaller, rebellious ones. In this case, it's a large, rebellious one and a very small, yet powerful nation, I guess. It's a little flipped on its head, but if you take it on the principle of things, the Americans are objectively weaker than the British. They don't need to win the war. They don't need that decisive victory over the British. In the end, all they need the British to do is throw their hands up and say, okay, we're done. This isn't even worth it anymore. We don't feel like having this fight anymore. If they tie, the Americans win. The British have to defeat the Americans. So this is actually very well communicated in very few words, and I really appreciate that.
Outlast.
I love that part so much.
We're gonna fly a lot of flags half mast.
Raise a glass.
I'll go back to New York in my apprenticeship.
I ask for French aid. I pray that France is sent a ship.
I was gonna comment on the Lafayette part, but I just realized I don't think Mulligan was even there. Like, he wasn't actually in the army. He was a spy. He wouldn't have been... I don't think he has to go back to New York, because, like, he never left. Which is kind of funny. But, yeah, this is kind of like, let's get him out. He's going to make his exit, and you know he's going to come back later on with one of the best parts of the entire show. And I think most people are in agreement that that is one of the best parts of the entire show. But in real life, Mulligan wouldn't have even been with them.
New York and my apprenticeship.
I ask for French aid. I pray that France is sent a ship.
I stay at work with...
So Lafayette is... He's a decent kind of go-between between the French and the Americans, but it's not perfect. He doesn't have, like, crazy sway over there. I think there are definitely people who want to help, but not if this feels like a lost cause.
My apprenticeship.
I ask for French aid. I pray that France is sent a ship.
I stay at work with Hamilton. We write essays against slavery, and every day's a test of our camaraderie and bravery.
Like, Lawrence is such a good boy, isn't he? He just seems like such a good boy. He gives a lot of credit to Hamilton here. I would say give the biggest, when it comes to credit on the issue of slavery, give it to Lawrence. Lawrence is the one who's really working hard on that issue. He's directly trying to appeal to his father at this point, which I think during the time this song takes place, he is the president of the Congress. So, although he's not really participating in debate as much, because the president didn't really do that, he does have a bit of influence, a bit of sway. So that is important, and Lawrence is in the best position to get some change on this issue, or to get Lawrence's plan of having black soldiers. However, a lot of people are afraid of putting weapons in the hands of freed slaves, or even free black people. They're just really not a fan of the idea of doing that. What if they turn their guns on us? The British at this point, I believe, have already basically put out a notice, like, any slaves that come to fight for the British, we will free them. And that's a pretty good deal for them. So honestly, if you're a slave, you're better off siding with the British at this point in the war. But Lawrence, I guess, is trying to change that a little bit. I mean, the Black Battalion thing doesn't necessarily guarantee that they'll end up being freed after the war. Maybe he would prefer it, but there's a good chance, like, hey, you get that, they're just going to be returned. That's just what's going to happen.
Supply lines, we steal contraband. We pick and choose our battles and places to take a stand. And every day, sir, entrust me with the command. And every day, no, he dismisses me out of hand.
I don't... this is clearly an ego thing with Hamilton when he wants to... He wants to lead an army. He really... It's all just to make him feel a little bit better. Honestly, after the war, he would be fine. He's Washington's secretary. He's proven a whole lot, and Washington is going to be the man. So honestly, if Hamilton never ended up leading a battalion, if he never ended up being an actual military leader, I think his future would have been more or less unchanged. However, He really wants this, and he's reckless. He's like old school military glory wanting type of a guy, you know. It's a bit of an outdated way of thinking about rising up in the world, when really he's already risen up in the world significantly. He's with the guy in charge. He's married up a little bit. So Hamilton's upward mobility is pretty darn good at this point.
Instead of me, he promotes Charles Lee, makes him second in command.
I'm a general.
Yeah, he's not the choice I would have gone with. He shits the bed at the Battle of Monmouth.
This battle is infamous. I think the song does a pretty good job of describing it.
Everyone attack!
The visuals are so good. So yeah, they managed to, like, Lee, some people will argue this is incompetent, some people will argue that this is like treason what Lee did. I think he just had a different vision of what the army should be doing, so I would say it probably leans more on the side of incompetence. But the fact is, they're able to... Well, I think they end up saying this.
Soldiers die in 100-degree heat as we snatch a stalemate from the jaws of defeat.
Charles Lee was left behind without a pot to piss in. He started saying this to anybody who would listen.
Washington cannot be left alone to his devices. Indecisive from crisis to crisis. The best thing he can do for the revolution is turn and go back to planting tobacco in Mount Vernon.
So Lee is one of, I have head pigeons. Lee is one of many people who is going to be, okay, I'll see you later. Lee is one of the many people who's going to be speaking out against George Washington. A lot of people are fighting to get George Washington replaced. When you think about it, George Washington at this time is not George Washington. He's just George Washington. He's just some guy who had, some military rank, happened to be from Virginia. He was kind of like the perfect political decision to have in as the leader of the army. But his record wasn't always that great. People are going to question him, and Lee is just one of those people, and he's not alone.
Do a thing, history will prove him wrong.
But sir,
we have a war to fight, let's move along.
Strong words from Lee, someone ought to hold him to it.
I can't disobey direct orders.
Then I'll do it. Alexander, you're the closest friend I've got.
Lawrence, do not throw away your shot.
Ooh, okay. So, like, yeah, that's like a double meaning there. Don't throw, and that's always a double meaning throughout the play, the don't throw away your shot thing. But, like, yeah, we're going to be getting into one of the actual duels. And Ten Duel Commandments is, I don't know if it's one of my favorite songs, but I love that it's an homage to the Ten Crack Commandments by Biggie Smalls. It's very well done. So there's going to be a lot to break down with that. Yeah, I really enjoyed this song. So Washington at the end, he's like, don't do anything. And this kind of represents Washington's greater reputation for being kind of the bigger man in a lot of situations. He could get furious when he was questioned, but he was also very good at brushing things off and picking his battles politically. He was very careful in that sense. So that kind of represents a broader thing in Washington's personality. And we get that very often with his character. I think if you're looking at any of the figures from American history and how they're portrayed in the musical, I think Washington is one of the best. I think everybody walks away thinking probably a little more of Washington, or at least believing in him a little more as a human than as a symbol, like respecting him a little bit more. I always found that, because there is a lot of truth in what it does. And even when it's not necessarily true, a lot of the stuff that he does represent like broader ideas that reflect the real Washington. So there's a lot of cool stuff there. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let me know what other Hamilton songs you... Well, I'm going to do all of them eventually, so is it really even worth giving me suggestions? I will get around to them all, probably. I don't know. But yeah, that was fun. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I will... What are you doing? Hold on, I'm going to have to... Oh, there he goes. Bird's causing trouble. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you like it, subscribe for more content every single day, and I will see you guys next time. Thank you.